All right, so today I have a very special guest with me. It is Aura or Jamie. Actually, I should have asked you, what do you prefer to be called just when you're being talked
to? Either is fine. I mean, you can call me Jamie because I feel like, you know, we know each other, like, you know, but I honestly don't mind. I mean, you know, it's like a weird thing. I don't really know.
Very interesting because my name is Aviva. So
is your name actually Aviva?
Yeah.
What's such a cool name? Oh my gosh.
Yeah, it's jeez, so different like a, for me because it doesn't really matter what I get called. It's all
yeah, of course.
Me.
It's all
but yeah. I didn't want to wrongly name you because I know some people get sensitive about that.
No worries. No worries.
Well,
at all.
I'll call you Jamie. But you that are listening or watching this may know Jamie as Aura. And could you start for me by maybe talking a little bit about who you are and what you do for anyone that might not be familiar with you?
Yeah, sure, of course. So yeah, I'm Aura. What's up? I am a singer-songwriter. I've been writing music since I was a kid and have somehow ended up making it my career. And that's kind of what I do. I just write stuff and make, you know, stories out of them and visuals and kind of try and connect with people that way. Yeah.
Awesome. That is awesome. Sounds very familiar.
Oh yeah, that's what we do, huh? So,
the old songwriting secret.
Oh yes, yes. That's
so good. I don't know if you know when you started exactly, but has it been 6 years, 10 years, 15 years, or it's just kind of been like you from a musical background, so it's just constant? That's my experience, so I don't have like a start date particularly.
I mean, yeah, same here. I think it, I mean, my parents are in the music industry, so for me it was like it was always something that was very much, you know, in the household. Like my parents were always in the studio working, and because my dad's a producer, my mom's a songwriter, and so it was very like natural to go into music. And although it wasn't really supported initially by my dad specifically, which was funny, I had to kind of convince him to like let me do this, which is so weird. But I was quite young. I was like maybe 10 when I told him that I wanted to do music as a career. So like, no wonder. But I would say I started like seriously pursuing it as like a thing that I wanted to do with my life when maybe I was like 13. Yeah.
That's awesome.
Yeah,
though.
But I mean, yeah, I guess so. I mean, what about you? Did that kind of just come about naturally?
I started piano lessons when I was 3, and then I started violin when I was 4.
Yeah,
so I was playing amazing instruments from when I was really young, but I always liked to sing. I always wanted to sing and I always could sing, but I was discouraged from doing singing lessons until I was much older because the way the voice develops, it's not actually good to be putting too much strain and pressure. So when I was 13, I think I started training classically and I wanted to be an opera singer, and then I wanted to be I wanted to be in musical theater because being an opera singer is really, really cutthroat, and I was just not sure if I was made out for that. But it turns out that all of music's fairly cutthroat, so it doesn't really matter what genre you're in.
it really doesn't turns out, plot twist. Oh yeah. Yeah,
so that's my and like my family all play music, and music's such a big part of the culture and the life of my family, so it was never really a surprise to anyone.
Okay.
I also did study, so I was a high school teacher for a few years, so that was like, yeah. I taught music.
Oh my gosh. Music in high school.
Yeah,
that's so cool.
Yeah,
I would have never thought that you actually had time to like go and do that before you started. Like,
wanted to study something and do something while I was doing the music stuff, really setting it up so that I could live comfortably, because I like to do things and go places, and I didn't want to be like a starving artist. So there you go, did that. And then music was like too much in a good way, and I couldn't do both. So I was like, you know what, I'm retiring from teaching, but I still love the kids that I taught. So many of them keep in touch. It's really awesome.
Oh my gosh, that's very cool. That must be so cool for them to actually see like their old teacher like releasing
doing something.
Music and doing stuff. Like, that's, I can't even imagine. Like, all of my music teachers were like, you know, it was very like classical and like from that kind of side, not from like alt pop. Like, that's really cool.
I was an anomaly.
That's awesome. Very cool. My gosh.
Yeah.
So that's different. That is, yeah. I mean, for me, hearing that is so funny, because like, I'm actually a high school dropout. So I didn't even finish high school.
Tisk.
Yeah, I know. It's I'm actually like the first person in my family like that's done that. So it's definitely a bit of a scary thing to decide to do. Let's just say that.
I can imagine.
Yeah.
It would have been contentious.
Like, let's just say my grandmother's not impressed by that. Like, to this day, every single time I call her, she's like, oh, Jamie, are you gonna do school? Are you gonna finish school? And I'm like, grandma, no, I have a job. Don't worry, maybe one day, but not now. But
that's so funny.
I don't know. Maybe one day. Who knows?
Yeah. And there's lots of ways that you can learn in different ways anyway. Although if you are listening and you're in school, don't leave, because school does have benefits.
It definitely does. It definitely does. I think my case was purely an exception. Usually it is very good to stay in school.
Yeah, exactly. So tell me, what does living a creative life mean to you?
Ooh, is this one of the question questions?
This is one of the questions off my list. So thanks. So official.
Ooh, living a creative life.
Yeah, because that's what this podcast is all about. It's all about creativity.
Ooh. Oh, I'm gonna have to like think about that one. I don't know. It's so strange, because like everything that you live through, it's like, you know that you're gonna end up sharing that with people in some way someday. And I think I find that really interesting, because it's you know, you're in some way so open about what you're going through. And although, like, you know, I personally really love writing things in metaphor, so it's like hard to understand exactly what it means, but oh yeah, that's nice too. But sometimes, you know, there are songs that I make that are a lot more raw, and it's just like, wow, this is, I'm gonna look back at these and be like, this is like the different stages of, you know, my friendships and relationships and how I was feeling mentally. And I don't know, I just recently realized that, you know, I might look back at that when I'm really old and be like, oh, that's all out there now. And I that's just really wonderful. And it's cool that, you know, there's going to be people that have also connected to that while they were going through things like that. And they can hopefully think back to those too. I don't know. It's such a weird, I don't know. I'm really like nostalgic already, which is really strange, because it's like, I'm obviously still a baby, but it's just, I don't know. Like, it's weird to think of how the future could be when we look back at what, you know, we're doing now. I don't know, creatively.
Like, yeah, well, that's really true. And if you could give yourself a piece of advice when you were starting out, even though, like you said, you're still only just a baby in the grand scheme of things. were able to talk to past Jamie, what piece of advice would you give her?
Ooh. Honestly, I feel like I'd still give her the same advice right now. Like, I'd still tell myself this in this moment. Just to not overthink things so much. And try and just go with the initial gut feeling, just not second guess myself so much.
It's so true. You can get really caught up in your head, can't you? Not you, but like people.
Yeah. No, definitely me. definitely me too. Yeah. Oh, I think everybody has those moments, but you know, there are just people out there that are a lot you know, that have decided to just like
be more thinky,
live their life and be more, yeah, I know.
Yeah, or less thinky it should be. They just
less more decisive and more, yeah, just like, yeah, let's do it. And I'm like, oh, that's, you know, it is a cool attitude to have. It's good to think about things carefully, but also good balance between the two. I would tell myself that a lot more.
Well, that's a good piece of advice, finding that balance between giving it a go and being mindful of what it is that you're actually going to be doing.
I give that advice to anyone, actually, because it's just good in general.
It is. Isn't it? It is really good. I have got it's kind of like a two-pronged question, if that makes sense. So how do you overcome obstacles like self-criticism, which links to what we were talking about anyway, being in your head, self-criticism, creative block, negative feedback, things like that. How do you overcome those obstacles, which is kind of slash what do you do when you're not feeling it or you're feeling stuck? So to me, they're two very different questions, but to you, they might be kind of together. Because the obstacle of self-criticism is a very different thing to me than just not feeling it. But for a lot of people,
yes, I get
self-criticism that then stops them.
Makes you not feel it.
Yeah.
Yeah. Huh. I think, honestly, I think they might be two separate ones for me as well. I definitely, like when it comes to obstacles, like actually like circumstantial obstacles or just like any...
Anything that's an obstacle in you doing the thing that you do.
So recently, that's been a running theme. Oh, gosh. Yeah. I mean, obviously, you know, everybody's going through some sort of obstacle anyways because of COVID-19. But that's like specifically that. And I'm getting so tired of talking about it. Because I feel like everybody's just heard so much about
it. There's no questions here.
Deal with it. It's like... there you go. But just kind of the circumstances that has put me in creatively, I would say, just to answer it that way. That's definitely been pretty hard for me because a lot of like ideas that I've had haven't been able to actually like come to fruition because of like, you know, that kind of stuff. And I think it's interesting because like there's so many artists that are at like different, because they're in different countries, it's like they can do different things. And like some people are just putting content out there like normally and then others aren't able to, and it's just like, so that's been like a huge thing for me recently. I'm just like, oh gosh. But obviously, you know, it's awful and we all want to be over, so that's just how it is. And then really what I've been doing is just trying to get myself to have like less expectations and try and find a way to still express myself and have those ideas like happen in some sort of other way with like different medias and just trying to like, you know, come up with outside of the box ideas. Totally. That's really been a lot of that recently. And yeah, I mean, really it's just to overcome that, it's been just like trying to think of things creatively in a completely different way than I used to, which has been really refreshing as well, honestly. Like it's been good as well. But yeah. And then could you actually repeat the other question again?
The other question was...
other part of it.
The other part, what do you do when you're not feeling it? Like on those times when you're just not feeling the...
just not wanting to...
yeah.
Mm. Hmm. Honestly, if I'm not feeling it, I step away. I step away for a bit because if I force myself to still continue like trying to work or trying to like work on something, especially like... you know, if it has to do with writing, if I have a writer's block and I'm just like forcing myself to write, I'm not going to like what I write. Like, I'm not going to like it. So it's, so most of the time what I do is just try and like step away from it, try and consume some other like creative thing, like, you know, like movies, books, TV shows, like just watch something else or listen to music other people have made and just like, you know, look at other things that people have created and just kind of like ground myself in what I want to do again and then like get back to it.
Come back with fresh ears and mind.
Yes.
I totally know what you mean. And what sort of things do you do? I call it filling my creative well when I do the things that feed me creatively and feed my soul and refresh me and the room that I'm in right now is obviously not a music studio. It's my art studio. The desk is where I do my writing, and I do a lot of arts and crafts and sewing and stuff like that. That's how I like to feed my creative well. What sort of things do you like to do? Or like, what sort of things do you like to watch? Like you mentioned movies and TV and stuff.
Yeah, by the way, that's really cool that you like that you're arts and crafty. I really have respect for people when they're like that, because I can't draw, I can't like do anything that requires like, detailing.
No.
Oh yeah, no. I mean I doodle. I love doodling, but that's really just like a side kind of expressive distraction while I'm writing. I really love writing like stories, like creative writing, like even just from writing prompts, like just giving myself a prompt or like looking them up on, you know, Wattpad or whatever, like just finding something to write about. I watch a lot of anime, so I got a lot of inspiration from there.
What's
too.
Your favorite anime?
My favorite? Oh, that's a big question.
ever. If you could only watch one ever, more and you had to pick one to watch, what would you pick? I know what I would pick.
I mean, it has to be a long one. So I feel like the natural answer there is Naruto. Because like,
incredibly long one.
If I'm going to pick one to watch forever, I could probably make that happen with Naruto. But yeah, I grew up like watching a lot of anime, and like it's just I've always been kind of a weeb, so I love that. I love gaming as well, so I kind of get a lot of inspiration from there too, actually.
What games do you like to play?
I play a lot of Minecraft. I play like a lot of like RPG games. Uh-huh. Like Final Fantasy, Gravity Rush, Horizon Zero Dawn, like those kind of like storytelling games
in those kinds of worlds.
Yes love those kinds of worlds so much. And yeah, like that kind of thing. I also play Animal Crossing and like all the, you know, all the games.
My friend keeps telling me to play Stardew Valley, and I'm like, it looks cute, but I don't have a lot of time.
It's so cute. I haven't played it yet either. I've once played at my friend's house, but I don't think I could like invest a ton of time in there, but it's like a cute game.
It's cute, but it does look a little like Farmville. She's like, get on your Switch. I'm like, all right, maybe. No
problem. I mean, hey, that's the only time I really like love playing games like that is like on tour when you have like free time in the car.
Exactly, like, or you're on an airplane. Except when I'm on a plane, I prefer to read. Because I can like smash one or two books on the plane, and then I'm like, so just accomplished. Like,
that's actually the perfect time for that. That's so true.
Some people can't read on planes, or they can't, like, they just only watch movies. But I like to basically read a book and then listen to a book while I feign sleeping. Ooh. And then if I drift in like and out, it doesn't matter. Yeah, like an audiobook. That's what I usually do. One for my brain, and then one for my brain to be like, okay. Sometimes it's so hard to sleep on a plane, and now I'm all wigged out about planes because I haven't been on one in so long, and no one has, and they haven't been running. Anyway, that's a whole other
thing
conversation.
Jeez. Yeah, planes. Not a plane,
you know what I mean?
A plane.
Yeah.
Oh gosh. Okay, one day it'll go back to.
We'll get back there eventually, hopefully.
Hopefully, yes. Oh gosh. I really hope so.
I just changed the camera on my screen because I had it so you were really big, but then I realized because I'm recording it, then it would just go between you and me and you and me and not be side by side. And I didn't think gallery view worked with two people because I'm like a technological Luddite, but I did it and it worked. So now we are pretty face by face or side by side. Face.
Got you.
And I mean, it doesn't change yours, and I can see it's all still working. So.
Okay, got you. Okay, so you can still work with the stuff before as well.
Yeah. Okay, it's just going to be like two. So if you're watching this and all of a sudden it's just like, whoa, you'd be like, okay, that makes sense now. I got it.
Got you.
But anyone that knows me or watches anything that I'm doing technology will know that's a very classic Aviva thing to happen.
Oh,
I don't do the technology. I'm a analog gal.
Which is also cool, obviously.
Exactly. Cool in a different way. Now, you're so young and you've accomplished many things in your short time here on the planet so far. So I think it's a difficult question I'm about to ask you. Everyone has a different answer. Sometimes when I ask people that are much older, their answers are different to what I expect because I don't know. I was being ageist in my mind. I can't tell. But what do you define as success? Because I used to have like a set point of what I thought success was. But the more I have done this and now this is my profession, the more I'm realizing that what I thought was success isn't. So what do you define as success? Big questions. I only ask big questions.
It's a big question. That is a big question. I think same as you, I used to have a very different definition of it growing up. I think like that definitely changed in the past couple of years. I don't know. I think growing up, you see your idols, you see, you know, like fame depicted, and it's something that, you know, all of us as little kids kind of might dream about a little bit. And I think, I don't know, like as tempting as all of that is, it's honestly, I think success within that for me, that's like, honestly, just being able to have people to share my music with, like just to have people listening to it and for that to be like enough people so that I can obviously still you know, I think people forget that you have to like actually live off of like being an artist as much as, you know, it's purely passion and, you know, creativity. It definitely is still a job, which is so weird. Doesn't seem like that to us and most to anybody of most of the time, because it's amazing. But I think just, you know, having enough people there to kind of be on the journey with me and just, I don't know, like numbers are cool, I guess, but it's just, you know, I think fan bases are incredible and the most important, and just 100%. having a strong fan base, having, you know, like people that will always listen to you and to your music, that is awesome. I think that just like having a close connection to them, and that is definitely made me feel successful. I think, yeah, and of course the other things are, you know, like I said, numbers are nice to hear, but it's just in the end, like truly the magical sparkly feeling comes from the connection that you make with your audience. Yeah. But that's kind of, I would say, yeah. And nowadays it's purely on social media, but I think,
yeah, because there's no touring.
Yeah, of course. But when you get to do that in real life and actually like physically see them,
amazing.
You know, it's incredible. And I think, yeah, my God, I miss it so much. But it's just that honestly, all I ever wanted growing up was to be able to like have like a concert and have like, you know, a group of people there that wanted to hear me sing and perform and listen to my songs. That's really it. And, you know, that's, I had like a venue in my mind and everything. And it's just like, that's, for me, that's still like one of my goals. I think I was able to get that feeling again of just standing in front of that crowd.
It's kind of always changing, isn't it? Like you reach one goal, which was like the pinnacle of your thing that you are creating, and then all of a sudden you're there and you're like, this is amazing, and maybe I can do this, and then you're like,
over here.
And I think that's healthy because it keeps you aspirational and it keeps you working hard, and I think that's really important. Otherwise, what's the point if you're just gonna be doing the same thing?
Yeah, no, there's like, it's hard to have like one big fat goal. It's like you want to kind of like naturally have yourself evolve that way. And then also, exactly. You know, it's like they're all like little milestones that should be celebrated. And, you know, you never, like, honestly, my goal in the beginning was just even like have a song released and like make a music video. And I think, you know, when you're on top of that hill and you've actually done that, you don't really look back. You just keep on looking forward. So it's like, it's hard to actually, like, you should just stay so appreciative of like where you started, you know, like it's interesting. It's a weird thing.
It is a weird thing. It all kind of takes its own life. Like You stop even like consciously choosing where you want to go next. It just kind of naturally progresses and you're like, yeah, this is awesome. I didn't even think of this. Cool. Of course.
Yeah, exactly. And I think that's, I mean, having that mindset is very cool. And I think that is the right way to go. Kind of just letting life happen to you and trying your best along the way. I mean, that's all that we can really do is just.
100%. Yeah. It is. Yeah. You mentioned at the beginning of that question, like you would look at people that you were a fan of. So who are some of the people that are your creative heroes? Who are some people that inspire you or have always inspired you or newly inspire you?
That's always changed kind of a bit from like when I first kind of started making music to now, but like those people still inspire me in ways because that's kind of like initially where I got inspired from, you know. It's interesting. I really love Lana Del Rey. Oh yeah, she's amazing. When I first discovered her, I think she kind of opened up the idea to me that you could make different kinds of, like, I don't know, like her music was just like weird and beautiful, and I hadn't really heard like pop music like that before. Yeah. And I don't know, like she just kind of opened up the whole genre to me, I guess you could say. I mean, you know, genres are hard, but I mean, Amanda is still some sort of thing to orbit around. She opened up that whole perspective for me, and she was kind of like the first artist that I discovered like completely by myself, and my parents hadn't like shown me. So I felt very like, yeah, like, oh, this is so cool. And that was right around video games too. Like very, I think I was like 9 years old or something.
I was older than 9, but it was the same song, that film clip, and how it just looked like it had been done. And you were just like, I could do that.
Yeah. Exactly. That's exactly that's it. It just kind of made me feel like, oh, I could just take matters into my own hands and just try something, you know? Mm. I could just try something. And she definitely inspired me to do that. I started uploading like YouTube videos after that. So that was kind of a direct inspiration. Yeah, she's amazing. And other than her, another artist that really like inspired me, and I actually had a fan page for,
was
Ariana Grande.
Oh, really? You had an Ariana fan page. Please tell me you are still running that. It's Ariana Daily.
It's actually still like, oh my gosh, yes. By now we have millions of followers. Oh my gosh. No, it's deactivated long ago, but. Yeah, I was Ariana stan, and that was, oh my gosh, it's funny to think back at that, because I had never ever thought that people would be making fan pages to do with me someday. I looked back at it the other day and I was like, wow, like I put a lot of work into these edits. Like it's like, you know, like the video edits, the photo edits, I made like all of that stuff for
I think she's awesome, and what she does is really, really cool. I don't love every single one of her songs. I think I was a bigger fan with a previous album, but my fanage can go in and out based on an album with those sort of really pop stars sometimes, whereas Lana Del Rey, I'm like, she can do no wrong. Everything she puts out is art.
But you see, that's me. That's where I'm like, it doesn't matter what she does, I will always love her. Like, that's the kind of, it's just because I, like, you know, I grew up with, like, Victorious, and then after that I just, like, followed on, you know, to her career. And yeah, I think, like, from 10 to 13 I was, like, running the fan page full on, like,
Ariana is every, life.
Yeah, basically. I, like, we went on a road trip in the States to one of her concerts when I was a kid with my best friends, and we, like, I still have this photo of, like, me and, like, you know those, like, skater, like, skirt, like, things, you know, that she used to wear with, like, the, like, yes, the big, like, shoes and the thigh-high socks and, like, the crop tops and the cat ears.
Yep.
And
oh, that's why you're wearing you bought the I know what you're doing.
Oh, hell no. Yeah, I'm secretly still letting the fans who are we kidding? Oh my gosh. Yeah, these are not. It's to do with that. But I have a picture of me with, like, all of that and, like, the cat eye, like, winged eyeliner, which I would never wear. And me and my best friend are, like, dressed like Ariana Grande, and, like, we look like we're trying to look like her, you know, and then we have, like, the little, you know, those little arena glowing things, and we're like,
oh yeah.
And it's, I don't know, we were just like, I cried, like, we both were sobbing when she came on stage.
It's just like so amazing how you can be so moved by someone and someone's music and everything that they've put together, and it's just so overwhelming. I think that's so powerful. When I first saw Lana Del Rey live, I cried. And I was way older than 13. I was older than 13. I was like 17. And I was like,
you were 17. Where was it? Was
it Australia? Because she only came down here twice. And one of the times I was in America, so I missed it. Yeah, I know. So I was there and I went with my mom, and I'm just like crying. And then I was like, why am I crying? And then I was like, I'm crying because I want to be up there.
Yeah.
Like, I can do this.
And you're like, I need to do this.
Am I crying because I'm happy for you, or am I crying because I'm sad for me?
Yeah. Like, I'm sad because I want that to happen to me. Oh, that's hilarious. That's, I definitely had thoughts like that too. I was like, my gosh, it'd be so incredible if I got to do something like that as my, you know, as my career. And that's definitely where, you know, like, those thoughts also, like, kind of merged from and it all, like, kind of came together. It's this general thought, like, hey, let's try this music thing.
Yeah, maybe this isn't just playing around up.
Oh gosh, I mean, obviously came from so many different places, but it's that, you know, that just shapes you, like, watching, you know, people you respect and, like, inspire you on stage. And just, yeah, that was, like, my first concert too, so it was very, I was very, like, you know, and it was in an arena. Amazing. I was so overwhelmed because, like, I'm from an island, so that stuff doesn't happen here at all. Like,
no arenas. Never.
There's no arenas here. No, there's a cricket stadium, but
that's cool.
we don't use it for music, so
it's strictly sporting.
Yeah, strictly cricket. Yeah.
Ah, sports. No, thank you.
No, thank you.
So, what do you love most about living a creative life? Back to my questions.
Oh, yes. digressing. I really love one of my favorite parts, other than, like, writing and being on stage, is making, like, the visual worlds around each song and, like, kind of creating that, and, you know, like, the teasers and, like, just, you know, everything about, like, the storyline and the concept, and that I spend a lot of time working on that, and that is really just, like, I love that so much. I think, honestly, if I wasn't doing music, I'd want to do something with, like, writing and, like, in the creative world, like, film stuff, because it's just, it's so
gaming, even.
Yeah, sure, that's true. Oh my god. A little bit of all of it. I mean, it's all, and that's, I think that is what is also so incredible about music, is, you know, you get to explore so many different other areas of the creative world.
Totally.
It's quite incredible.
It is, it's really fun.
I love that.
And what awesome. Do you find to be your biggest challenge? I don't like to say like, what don't you like about it? So I rephrased it to, what is the biggest challenge doing this? And it could easily be the same thing, isn't it? Like, because there are so many easily. Elements.
Oh, yeah. Oh, my gosh. Because there's so much ground to cover. And, like, you just have to, yeah, no, it's a lot. It can be a lot for anyone mentally to be so, like, you know, it's your life as well. So it's like, it's an interesting thing to try and balance. I think I sometimes struggle with trying to balance my, like, life and then like my work life, although it is very much the same thing. I don't know, like I used to have like quite a lot of anxiety, so for me, like, as soon as I realized I don't have like control over everything and like I can't like not, you know, if like one thing isn't going perfectly or something, I tend to like freak out a little bit. And it's in like the past like couple of years, it's really been learning experience to try and just like accept the fact that things won't always go perfectly. Obviously that's just how life goes, and especially in the creative world, because it's like, I mean, you know how it is, you're like, you're trying to translate like what you see in your brain to other people, and sometimes it works so well and sometimes it just gets lost in translation. So it's like, you're just trying your best to like convey everything.
Okay, yeah.
And then sometimes it just doesn't go quite the way you want it to, and I think that also just means working together with people in a different way. It's just collaborating will end up getting you a slightly different product. It's just well, that can be beautiful as well. So I've definitely been, yeah, kind of letting myself collaborate more with people around me and like letting go of my absolute control freakism a little bit.
Yeah.
Just to not freak myself out and kind of just, you know, yeah, just
be chill.
That kind of thing. Just chill. Yeah. Comes to that, because it's hard. It's hard. You kind of have to figure out a way to balance it.
It is hard. I know what you mean. Sometimes, especially when you have a really clear vision of what you want, and it's possible because it's like a $300 million blockbuster.
Yes. Yeah.
And people are like, yeah, I love that, but that's just not reality right now.
Yeah. Or possibly like ever. That's a great idea, but that will, you know, make us.
How do we take it from here to here and just really hone in on that one point? I'm like, but it's my
idea. You're like, yeah. What do you mean? You want to strip the entire thing?
Yeah. It's like, you don't even believe in my vision.
Yeah. Oh, gosh.
That's so funny. Oh, then you realize, actually, it's like, very true.
Like, that is very true, and there are such things as budgets, and they do exist for reasons, so we have money to eat. Yeah. Oh, it does.
So funny. Just before we because I don't want to take up too much of your time, and I will have to go in a minute for another call, I have always got a last question, which is, what is one song that has it's an intense question, you're gonna like pass out. What is one song that has influenced you most in your life? And I know that's a nearly impossible song. What? But I can put a song in the podcast, so I like to put a song from my guest. So okay, think about that in the back of your head while we wrap it up, and then tell me what the song
okay.
is.
Yes. Okay. So you want me to, should I tell you afterwards? Or?
Well, you can tell me now if you've already got it.
If I already have it?
Yeah. That's crazy.
I mean, I think honestly, just because we were just talking about her, and that was kind of like my gateway to like exploring different kinds of pop music or different kinds of, you know, sounds. I would say Video Games by Lana.
Yeah. I was wondering if you were going to say that one. I was like,
I mean, The Way by Ariana Grande. I love The Way. Yeah, no. I love that song. But no.
She's been through so many versions as well, when you think about it. I mean, you look at that, like, so many versions. But Video Games by Lana. Great choice. Excellent. Well, we will put that one in there. what else was I going to say? Oh, I was going to say, yes, we should collaborate on something creative together. I think that would be really cool.
I think it would be too.
Trying to incorporate as many of our big ideas as possible.
I think there's quite a lot.
But I think that would be fun to do something like that. Is there anything else that is cool or interesting that you wanted to share with me that you can think of? Or any questions that you wanted to ask me before we go? Now I've given you the...
I'm like, do you want me to ask you a question? Like in between, I guess. Yeah, I guess. Actually, I would like to ask you how you balance the creative and the life, and how you've like figured that part out.
That's a good question. I don't think that I have figured it out. I don't think that I will ever fully figure it out. I find that I am a very emotional person and I'm very passionate and I feel my emotions very strongly and I am very reactive. So that's why I have this room. Like, this is my sort of space. Doing the other creative stuff is my way of maintaining a kind of balance in my head. So long as I feel like I can express myself creatively, then I'm okay. I can't not be doing something creative. That's when I get a bit anxious. That's when I get stressed. So as I think you already know, like, I'm an author and I'm working on my trilogy.
How's that going, by the way? Side question.
It's awesome. I have some exciting news, but I can't share it just yet because there are people listening. But I do that. So sometimes I'm in here. I go to bed pretty early, but sometimes I'm in here like all day writing. And then I have a break for lunch and then I come back in. And I don't even really like compute that's what I'm doing. And I see a chiropractor and he's like, you got to stand and sit. You can't just be sitting or just standing at your desk all day. And I'm like, I know, but I'm just like in the zone.
Yeah, if you're in the zone, you're in the zone.
But when I'm doing, even if I'm doing something that's completely random, like I'm looking around this room and it's literally filled with the most random stuff that I do, it all helps feed me creatively. I don't really watch that much TV, but I read a lot. I read probably 2 or 3 books a week. So I'm constantly just doing those things because, and I think part of it is because I'm a Viva 100% through and through. There's no like taking off my Aviva hat. I'm always Aviva, which is very interesting and unique. I don't think a lot of people experience that because often people will have a different name or a band, but you know, I'm super engaged on socials and I'm always talking to the fans and I love them and it's amazing, but I'm also really cognizant
that, pays off.
It does pay off. I'm cognizant that I need to be keeping creative. So I've got to fill my creative well. So I try to like ease off on weekends, even though I run my own business. I call it a business. I do my own artistry. It's my own career. I don't have to choose weekends. I just do. I write on weekends, but I only write for about 4 hours. I don't do like an 8 to 10 hour day. And we do music, obviously. That goes without saying. But again, that doesn't really feel like work.
Yeah.
The only thing that feels like work is when you have to like have meetings and stuff like that, which is fine because I like everyone that I'm meeting with. When I didn't like everyone that I was meeting with, then it felt like real chore. But now I've weeded out people that I don't like. That sounds horrible. That makes me sound like a horrible person, but you can't work with people that you don't trust or that aren't right for you. You got to work with people that fit the vibe.
Yes, they must fit the vibe. I agree. And that's not horrible at all. That's, I totally get that.
So I think to answer your question, it sounds like I'm always going, and it is because I don't really take a break, because for me, doing the arty crafty sewing, reading, that is secret work. It feels like it's leisure for me, but it all feeds back into my writing and my songwriting.
Exactly. So there you go.
Yeah. And so I'm trying to learn to be better at doing nothing. But I say that's when I'm reading. When I'm reading, I'm doing nothing. And then people will be like, but you just finished two books and it's already Wednesday. I'm like, yeah, but I'm doing nothing. I'm just reading. But reading's awesome.
That is very cool. I'm actually really glad I asked you that, because that's so interesting. Like, to just, like, I don't know, hear that from other people, like how they work around, like, their, and let out their creative, you know.
For some people, like watching TV or watching movies or playing games or, you know, going and doing sport. Well, for some people, I get up at 5:30 and go for an hour walk every day. I do that, because otherwise I wouldn't do any physical exercise. So I have to do it in the first hour of my day.
Yeah.
But otherwise I'm just like, no, thank you.
I get that. I do get that.
It's pretty gnarly. But yeah, that's why I like to do these interviews, because I love hearing how other people live their creative lives and what they do.
Yeah.
And similarities and differences. There are some people that work like 3 hours a day or something like that. And they're like, then I like to just chill out and watch TV. And I'm like,
how do you do that?
I'm watching TV, I'm still doing something with my hands. I'm cooking.
Oh, geez, you're still stuff. Well, that's but that's so cool. I think it's like, yeah, when I'm kind of a night owl, like I don't really sleep that much, but when I when I'm up, like I kind of like after 10 I can do my leisure things, which is like gaming and watching stuff, and
yeah,
mostly gaming but also watching stuff. And before then, it's I can't really. Like if I'm doing something else that I consider not being like work, although like for me, I do, because I feel like it's gaming and like that kind of stuff, I do like kind of separate it as like, that is not work. Like, of course, you know, it's good for me to, you know, be good at gaming and stuff, because like it feeds back into what I do, but like I need to, you know. So before then, I will like actually feel guilty for doing anything else. Like if I'm not, like I have to, I'm working on that as well, like just letting myself chill sometimes, being like, it's okay, we can do that, that's also fine. So yeah, I really admire your work ethic. That's like, that's really cool to hear that. Oh, you know, you. It's like so integrated in your life, and the art stuff is like that's so cool. I need to pick up some, I don't know,
something. Even doing puzzles, I do. Well,
that's just it.
You can just like do puzzles and stuff like that. That's creative in a different kind of way. It's problem solving. Problem solving is creative. Not everyone's creative in like the same way. So you just got to try everything until you find the things that vibe with you.
Yeah, you really do. That's how it goes.
Anyway, I don't want to cut you off, but
no worries. I think
yeah, we've had such good fun together. We should do this again.
This was actually very, very fun.
I really enjoyed having you, and I'm sure everyone will enjoy listening and learning more about you. We are going to listen to video games by Lana Del Rey now.
I hope you guys already know it. Yeah. Here we go.
Yeah, exactly. If this is your first time, wow, your mind is about to blow.
Get cultured. Yes, thank you for having me.
Have a amazing rest of your night and week, whatever time it is for you now. It's 8 a.m. for me. And I had, great fun.
Yeah, me too. Thank you so much for having me.
So, you are more than welcome. Cool. Bye.
Speak to you soon. Bye.